President Levy, board member, distinguished audience, it's extreme pleasure for me to first see our names on this wall of fame, and of course also to receive the honorary degree. And what I will try to do is to tell you with some pictures my pass from Kibbutz to the Nobel. One footnote that I remember this auditorium, I'm among the very few people who study here in the 60s. I remember Professor Avidor, Professor Ginsburg giving lectures, as usually set where my brother-in-law sit now, and took notes. It will go more or less like this. And my parents were born and grew up as kids in Poland. Essentially, when I was in Lodz 3 weeks ago, I tried to find where are these places. So this is Vladimir, they call it Ludmir, so I could not find it. This is my mother. And this is my father's family, came from Lachowicz. Both places are now in Belarus. And they joined youth movement and went to Palestine to build a kibbutz. This was in the early
70s. המשימה מורכבת ואין מקום לטעויות. רק יום אחד יש בידינו, יום אחד בלבד. ואז, אחרי תקופת המתנה ממושכת ומתוחה, זה קורה. כ"ב בטבת, תר"ש צדיק זין, החמישה בינואר 1937. ניל ארמסטרונג חוגג יום הולדת 7 וחולם על הירח, ומעמק חרוד יוצאת שיירה אל עבר הנקודה. עם טרקטורים ואוטומובילים, עם תבניות לחומת מגן, חצץ, מגדל וזרקור, כלי עבודה ומזון לציוד חדשה. צועדים נקודת התיישבות רעננה צצה בגאון, קיבוץ חדש בלב העמק הנאה, עם נוף לגלעד ולגלבוע, עלה לקרקע קיבוץ השדה.
Okay, so first it was called Asade, but as usually some functionary, Nachum Sokolov, got his name, so it was called Sde Nachum. And it was the second kibbutz for what was called Choma u'Migdal, or Tower and Stockade. We will discuss this priority. The one kibbutz before it was kibbutz Tel Amal, which I will mention later. This is my mother in 1940. You see, they live in tents. My father, who worked originally in the fish ponds, these are the fishes, and essentially later I also work in this occupation. And okay, I also been apprentice to electrician. Anyhow, I grew up in the kibbutz. These are several stages, and in contrast to common perception, some movie and stories which were partially inspired by this great psychologist who spent 7 days in the kibbutz and considered real authority. So he wrote a book which everybody, when I was at Harvard and I went to eat Boston cream pie in the psychology building, all the lady psychologists were talking on this book. This book proposed, based on very short experience, that people who grew up in the kibbutz are not driven and have no ambition because they grow in a society, sleep in the same place, which appeared to be basically completely incorrect because it's really kibbutz members have been driven all the time. But this was the theory. I continue to grow up in the kibbutz. This is my family. And I was very curious and tried to do different experiments. Some of them are not politically correct today. No, this was from the tallest building in the kibbutz called Binyan Aleph, which was only two-story high. And they always landed safely. But, okay, it's good that my wife is not here. So this is my class, and in the last year, we moved and studied in what was called the unified class in Kibbutz and Harod. And essentially, it probably was one of the most, the nicest time in my growing up. And we did not study too much for what will become later science. Essentially, we study comparative economy. We study Otto Bauer, the short course of Tavarish Stalin, and this social economy, which would have been probably a good preparation for Nobel Prize in economy, but not in science. And Kibbutz had this point that they did not encourage to prepare for matriculation. They'd done everything so you would not pass it and you would not leave the kibbutz, which it's not a joke, and probably they were right from their point of view. So I went to the army. This is me in officer course. After this, this is during the army. And when I finish the army, I have to go to what is called a third year, where you go to young kibbutz and try to help. And at that point, I decided that maybe I want to study. And the commander in my unit says that if I will sign for 1 year, he will allow me to take any place that I want. So I took a place in the chief of staff where I could study at the evening and prepare for the matriculation, external matriculation. Grading the matriculation was not so high, because in contrast to the city people, they did not tell us what will be in the exam. So, no, it was even at that time. So the only place which accept me would be the Technion, provided that I will pass the concourse, which was very tough, and I pass it. And then I study, including in this auditorium. And at some stage, the Technion have very nice tradition of having for third or second year a project. And I took a project which is related to enzymes. And for people who don't know, enzymes are molecules that do chemistry much faster than the regular chemist in solution. So they cut molecules billion and billion times faster than what usually happen, and I become interested in how do they work. So these are enzymes. And my instructor was Yechiel Shlitin, with whom we done basically try to check the effect of electrostatic forces on enzyme catalysis. By the way, you see that my name was spelled in different ways, in different times. And we concluded something that later I found out to be completely incorrect, that... No, but this was the experimental finding, that external electrostatic forces do not help to enzyme to be faster. However, I tried to measure very fast enzymatic reaction and used the NMR-60 with Aaron Levenstein. It just arrived with something that averaged signal and was able to measure probably one of the first fast reaction enzyme kinetics at that time. And another anecdote from the Technion is that I took physics with physicists from this complicated book, Merzbacher, and I did not fully understand what they were talking about, but the lecturer, a very good one, always says that while it's very hard to understand what happened in a collision, there are always solutions near infinity called asymptotic solution, which allow you to solve the problem. And I told one of the physicists that I will one day develop asymptotic wave function for enzymes without knowing exactly what it is and what is an enzyme. So, and essentially it turned out to be correct. One of my most powerful approach is kind of asymptotic approach. It's called the EVB. Maybe we talk about it for 2 minutes. In the summer, I had to support myself, of course. So I work in Phoenicia. I work in the refinery where I was fired because I slept at night. But the last year, I was very fortunate to have a project here in the Department of Soil Science with Benjamin Tzur and Rafael Mukadi, who later died in the Six-Day War. And my project was related to water distillation. It was, we build membranes and we try to see which one is the best by calculating the diffusion constant. And what I was doing, I had thousands of numbers in a calculator, and I would try to get diffusion constant by million calculations, which I've done 8 hour days. And about that time, I heard from somebody who worked with Ruben Pounce that there are also computers. So, this was near the end of the summer, so I did not use computer for it. This is my class. And I had really great experience in the Technion, very good education. And in principle, I could have stayed here, but at that time, the Technion made several mistakes. One of them was that they thought so highly on themselves that they want the master to be 3 years, and they want you to pass 2 foreign languages. And for me, where my only C was in English, as you could hear, so it would have been 3 languages. I took audiovisual Russian for half a year, but decided to leave. And I read at that time a newspaper article about the new scientific director of the Weizmann Institute, Schneur Lifson. And what impressed me the most is that he was from Kibbutz near David, which is Tel Amal, and I told you they apparently were before us as the Chomar Migdal. And they also say that he is riding a bicycle. So this was enough for me, and I went to him and convinced him to accept me. And at that time, Schneur moved from statistical mechanics of helix coil transition to the idea that computers would be extremely powerful in understanding molecules, that it could substitute experiment. And the idea was that if you have a molecule, it could be smaller. A molecule is a connection of atoms by bonds. So you could describe these bonds as springs. So you could describe a molecule as a bunch of ball and springs. And if you adjust the springs to be similar to what are the actual forces in the molecule, you will have a molecular model. So this was an idea which several people thought about at that time, and Schneur's point was that he wants to get the best description of the springs based on fitting to many different experiments. So this is how you describe a molecule. And I start to work on it. This is the master ceremony at the Weizmann Institute. It's the only ceremony that I participate, except now honorary degrees. So it's the only picture I have. And then the Six-Day War arrived, so a short period, and when I came back, Mike Levitt appeared, and this is him, and this is Schneur, and together we developed programs that could calculate almost any molecules, and Mike realized that this could be used also for proteins, again describing them as ball and springs. And the main idea was that instead of looking on proteins by crystallography or other approach, or in addition, it would be nice to model them, and this should be done using a computer, because molecules or proteins are too large to probe them by any type of experiment, so you need a model. By the way, in science, you need model for everything, except that some people would not call it a model, and for complex systems, you need a computer. And the main computer was the Golem computer, so this is now, not then. And the questions that arise, since I was still interested in enzymes, was, well, you could describe the motion of molecules, their structure, but you want to see how this enzyme chop bonds. And the problem is as follows. You could describe stretching of bonds, but if you want to describe breaking bonds, then it's a little harder. Because when you break bonds, the electrons jump from one atom to another, and you have to be able to describe it by what is called quantum mechanics. Stretching the bonds is called molecular mechanics. Describing how the electron moving belongs to quantum mechanics. You could call it quantum chemistry. So after several stages, eventually at the mid-70s, we develop what is called now QMMM, where the idea essentially is relatively simple. You cannot do quantum mechanical calculation on a huge molecule like a protein, but you could do the calculation on a small part of the protein because it's few atoms and it's not so expensive, and then describe the rest by this ball and spring model. And this approach is a part of the overall strategy, which is multi-scale modeling. Let's see if it works. Which, if you have something that you're really interested in, and you have the rest, no, it refused to do it. Anyhow, in the real movie, this forest become very shaded, and you hardly see it, and the cut become clear. So you really have to decide what you are focusing on. Well, in the stage of developing it, I move to the MRC with Mike, and this was 1974, 70, the end of 75, and several major advances were done at that time. I will discuss one, this protein folding, which I will mention later. The accomplishment in writing this landmark paper, and this is being in Cambridge, and here is Sam in Cambridge. This is my sister-in-law, I promise to. Okay, and my daughters, which you will see again. So one of the things that I done also at that time, all of this basically in 1 year, was simulating the first step of the visual process where the light strikes your eye and it leads to a reaction where you have a rotation around one bond in a molecule, and then when the molecule called retinal rotate, it pushes the protein around it. The protein changes the structure and you have a sense of vision. So this was the first a molecular dynamic simulation of a biological process, and essentially it was described recently in this beautiful stamp. This is the eye, this is the rhodopsin, these are the cones or the rod. So it's a very nice early story. Just to move a little faster, at the birthday of Schneur Olifson, I already decided that the QMMM, the combining of quantum and molecular mechanics, could be simplified, and I developed an approach called the empirical valence bond, which is basically this asymptotic idea that I kind of talk about without knowing anything in my physics course. And in this approach, you could model chemistry in really large and important protein. This is a protein called RAS, where you break phosphate-oxygen bond, and when the protein is not a good one and you have mutations, you will get cancer. So this was studying molecular origin of cancer using basically computation. Almost in the same year, or a little later, we had a meeting at the Pontifical Academy. Mike is somewhere here also, but the main thing is my wife. And in this meeting, we introduce what is called free energy perturbations that allow you to do more really accurate quantitative calculations of chemical reaction in proteins. And this approach was used by me and others to study binding of drugs to proteins. Another interesting point is me and my daughters. It's Patrick Duffy, you know, but but this is from around the same time. And at that stage, we also advanced a lot in describing how electrostatic forces are acting in proteins, and the first important work was done with this person, Steve Russell, who was a good mountain climber. Other highlights, which are done more now, are modeling chemical processes in solution with much stronger computers and getting better description. In the meantime, we learn to use the computer to study how different the effect of mutating different groups in the protein, which is really the basic, like you could call it, molecular genetics, predicting the effect of mutations. We would validate it. And one of the most enjoying thing in having computer is that you could ask really deep questions and try to see what is right and what is wrong. So one of the questions I spent a lot of time and still spending now is trying to understand why enzyme works so much faster than the same reaction in solution. Yesterday I gave here a lecture on it, and it fortunately got several good questions. And it's something that you cannot solve by experiment alone. It's just impossible, and you have to use computers. It's not that everybody agrees with this, but this is a fact. And one of the things that we found with this computer experiment is that actually enzymes work by electrostatic forces. So we heard a lot about the Faculty of Electrical Engineering. It's all electricity. And also biology use it. There is also the field of designing enzymes, trying to make them better, that we spend a lot of time using these computer resources. In another direction, which was also quite interesting, you heard about Henry Taub, I mean, he gave here the prize, trying to understand electron transfer, which is one of the most important class of chemical reactions, by computer. So it's also something that the computer become extremely useful, and it helped, for example, for us to figure out what happened in the first step of photosynthesis where they award the Nobel Prize for solving the structure, but it did not really tell what is happening. And the first correct explanation, what happened in the first few picoseconds, came from computer simulation. Now, we have a few more minutes. So one direction that we push, so we could take molecules, describe them by computer, probe the inside, and try to understand how they work. Now, sometimes the molecules are really large, and you have to compromise between the computer time and what you want to ask. And one of the ideas for this, which we started with Mike in 1975, was to simplify the protein to replace the side chains by spheres, and in later years to teach these spheres to understand the electrostatic forces in the protein. And with this type of models, which involve a lot of simplification, that of course you have to validate, you could ask how very complex biological systems work. And for example, there are in our body and any cell small motors, molecular motors, where the structures of some of them are known. And the challenge is to take the structure and to actually understand what has happened there, not by talking about it, but to, by having computer models that reproduce what this molecule is doing. And in this case, like the motors that I show you, people who do single molecule experiment were able to see the work of the motor. They saw how it rotates. This is a movie which show how these ATPRs rotate. And the challenge was to understand what is happening here, to model it, and also to predict the correct forces. So again, with these simplified models, we could generate maps of the energy as function of the structure and advance the understanding to a stage where we could say what will happen if you change the motor. And in principle, how could you design nanomotors? Because most people who think about it have the wrong point of view and their motors will never work. So you see, this is how we understand this type of motors in physics. We strive to get similar descriptions on biological system. Typical problems, there is this molecule called myosin 5. It does work. It's kind of a robot that goes in one direction. There is a load here and it go only in one direction. And with our approach, we could understand why it goes in one direction. The same type of molecule also activate your muscle and so on. So understanding it could be useful for different degenerative disease. This is the explanation. There are what are called ion channels in our body where ions pass from one side of the membrane to the other. This is very large system. Many systems have this type of ion channels, so a lot of the drugs are aimed at them. You want to take the structure and to understand how it works. And while doing it, every time you have to develop, I will not call it new mathematics, new method, a new approach. And one of the things that I learned in the kibbutz, in the army, and so on, that you could always improvise and find a way to describe complex system by a computer. Not necessarily by brute force calculations, but by thinking what is important. Like in these ion channels, when you apply electric field, the channel open and the ion pass. Here, potassium pass, sodium does not pass. To solve this, I essentially have to develop models which could be used for battery. Like I was extremely amazed to see that nobody actually modeled two electrodes and a membrane between them and the current in them on a molecular level. There are a lot of continuum type descriptions which cannot be really correct, and you have to develop a model, and basically you have to simplify and decide where to simplify. This computational approach could be used to fighting drug resistance, and they could be used to understand signal transduction. Here is a model of the ribosome building peptides, which then have to pass through a protein called translocon, and they have to decide if they go to the membrane or outside. Again, you could use computer for it. So there are countless cases where you could use computer to describe biological processes, and it's all part of this multi-scale idea, which says that, well, there are small parts that we could describe very accurately, then there are bigger parts that we decide on what level we could represent them, and there is a lot still to do in this field. And eventually, and I talk mainly on my work, but a lot of this was collaboration with Mike. So anyhow, it eventually, with some luck, led to the Nobel Prize, which is very gratifying recognition of what one does. But even if you don't get a Nobel Prize, science is extremely fulfilling. It's one of the best jobs that you are paid to do what you would do anyhow. These are some of my co-workers, and of course this could not be done without my wife. I will say something that was advised not to say. So this is the prince with whom she sat in the reception. Anybody know what happened to this prince yesterday? Yes. Okay. So thank you very much.
So thank you very much for this fascinating and interesting and entertaining lecture. We appreciate that very much. Thank you. So first I want to thank you for being here today and to honor the Nobel laureates and the faculty that receive prizes and awards. And I wish you very much to enjoy the rest of your day and the rest of the program. So please don't run away because we have here a message. And thank you very much to everybody.